of the things I noticed is, I'd say particularly with Martin, is he brings in expectations of what a man is. And, you know, he sees himself as not fitting the bill in terms of what a man is, and that produces some anxiety and some insecurity.
Because it's a man thing, baby. I mean, you really wouldn't understand, you know? I don't want no other brother loaning my girl money, you know what I'm saying? I mean, if you need money, I'm the man. You come to me, baby.
But there were also other things at play, too, including each one of their vision for what a relationship was supposed to be, and also the pressure of Martin's friends, thinking that, you know, Martin was too whipped by Gina, or too at her beck and call, or too, you know, attentive to her, and that was somehow a commentary on his manhood.
I'm gonna prove it to you with the Stan Winters Are You Whipped test.
Whatever, Stan.
When she talks to you, do you ever find yourself listening? Go ahead, Stan. Martin, I don't need to go no further. You are so whipped, I could spread you on my sandwich.
Martin's already feeling sort of on the edge about this is what it's like to be a man. He has a very strong aversion to being whipped. And Tommy and Cole instigate. So they are supportive, but they also instigate and say, oh, you know, your house used to be a man cave.
Straight up?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, like your pad, right? Used to smell like a man's pad, you know? See? You know what I'm saying? Corn chips and stuff like that, you know. But now it just smell like potpourri up in here, man.
Yo, man, Gina put that in here.
Martin, your toilet paper, man. You see, the roll of toilet paper in your bathroom used to be white.
Mm. Yeah.
Now I believe it's pink and lavender.
You know, things like that instill some doubt into his mind.
All of that thinking may be exacerbated by what's going on with Martin and Gina, the education issue. Martin and Gina's relationship is what I see often in my office, where one of the partners is educated, formally educated, and the other is not. And it exacerbates maybe some existing problems that people typically have in marriages. The insecurity sets in with the partner who is not formally educated, and it causes a strain in the marriage because they can't communicate.
Look, I was upset. I was mad.
No, Martin, you're not mad. You're thoughtless and cruel.
Oh, man, here we go with the big words, Gina, with the big words.
He's invoking that rather than discussing the facts of the issue. That's his way of avoiding it. But he's not avoiding because he wants to avoid. He's avoiding because he doesn't know how to answer the question.
I'm still struggling with that concept because he always has a response when she says something.
Yes, but the response is not an intelligent response. If the response is, I'm a man and you can't talk to me like that, that's not a response. Great. Well, let me tell you one big rule. I'm going to repeat it again. Make the right choice. If you're an educated person and your spouse, your partner is not, and he has no intention of getting getting formally educated, then walk away from that situation. That is not a good situation.
I actually don't think it's Gina's problem. I mean, I think Gina's fine with making more money than him.
You know what they say about a man whose woman makes more money than him, babe?
What?
That I'm weak, I'm a punk, I'm nothing, I'm crumbs on the table, Gina.
And this is true for a lot of women. Oftentimes women don't see that as even an element at play. But for men, it very much is, because that's the stereotype. I take care of, I'm the protector.
I'm so sorry, I can't be a man that you need me to be in support of you. I'm so sorry.
This is a man thing, isn't it? This is a man thing.
Yeah, baby, it's a man thing, Gina.
I think if women can see that as coming out of a good place in a man, that I want to be your hero, I want to be everything to you, I want to provide for you and take care of you, then they can honor the intention, they can honor where it comes from, and still let him know, you're no less of a man to me. It's not about money. I don't care about the money. I care about you. The ways you show me that you're a man are by listening to me, by sharing yourself, by connecting with me, by making time for us. Those are the things that make a man to me, not how much money is in your paycheck.
So Martin and Gina's pattern of arguing would be something that we would work on in therapy.
Sorry, Gina, I'm sorry, all right? But most things you like are whack.
Damn it, Martin, you're doing it again.
I can't help it. You're too damn bougie,
Gina.
Don't
talk to me like
that. Don't talk to me like
that. You know what? You need to check yourself.
Check yourself, Gina. I ain't trying to hear it. I don't want to hear it. Shut up.
It's not uncommon that couples, when they're arguing, are really just waiting their turn. So, yeah, you're talking, but I'm putting together my points. I'm going to shoot you down on this. And that's not productive for anyone.
Gina, why'd you turn off the game?
Why are you watching TV while I'm trying to read?
Well, why can't you read in the bedroom?
Why can't you watch TV in the bedroom?
It's broken.
Well, fix it!
And this may be an advanced skill, but one of the things I have my couples at the very least think about before they enter a conversation is, well, is there a vulnerability that I'm bringing to this conversation? So for Martin, it may be, you know, I'm not employed right now. I don't feel good about that.
Gina, look at me. Look at me. I'm jobless, I'm living off my woman, and now I'm trying to sell your engagement ring.
And for Gina, it may be, you know, I'm really frustrated with him. I don't know if he's gonna stick this out with me, whatever the vulnerability is. To be able to slow the conversation down, and one person speaks at a time, the other person reflects back what is being said, and clarifies, do you understand what I'm saying? And then go from there.
The number one thing I'm looking for when I meet a couple client for the first time is, what's the investment here? How motivated are you to make this work? And sometimes people come in and they say, I'm not willing to do everything that I can do. And that's a problem. And we can talk about that, but ultimately I can't work any magic that's gonna create something that they're not interested in having. That being said, that's the minority of my clients. Most of them come in and say, I don't know what to do, but I just want to learn, so help me. And particularly with men, I think they deserve so much credit, because coming into a therapist's office, especially a female therapist with their wife, is scary and takes so much courage.
I'm talking about a marriage counselor, Martin.
Marriage? Gina, please. In high school, I didn't even go to my guidance counselor.
Would you please? Can we just try it?
That's it, Gina. No. No. Okay, my mind is made up. Marty Mard ain't going to no counseling. Okay, Mr. Marriage Counselor, let's do this, okay? Because my meter's running.
And I want wives and girlfriends to see that as them showing love right there by just coming in the office. You have to have hope to be in a relationship. One thing that I thought was hopeful is that after Martin lost his job, he expressly went on this sort of self, you know, this journey of self to try to find himself, which seemed really out of character with where he had been before. But I found hopeful because it showed a depth that maybe he hadn't showed to Gina, hadn't showed even to himself.
You know, with any relationship, there's time to evaluate, is this a good fit? You know, these things that really bother me about my partner, like for Martin and Gina, Gina is really upset by his temper.
Look, I'm only asking for you to watch your temper. That's just one small little itty bitty change, Martin.
Small change? That's who I am. I throw people out.
And so for her to figure out, can I work with that? Is something that I, you know, do I care enough about him that I can work with him in that? I talk with couples who are not married yet and ask them, you know, if the person never changed at all from this point forward, would you still be willing to marry them or, you know, continue your life with them? And so that's something to think about. I'm saying that people shouldn't change or anything like that, but when going into a relationship with someone, they're in their late 20s. They've been acting this way for 20-some years. And so any change would probably be slow, and it'll take a lot of work. And so even with that, are you willing to, you know, be with this person as they change and grow? And even if they don't.
Girl, all right, look, girl. You know what? I will try for you, Gina. I will try to watch my temper, okay?
I think Gina gets the best response from Martin when she's soft with him, when she's coming to him with vulnerability. And the worst response when she's in his face, yelling back at him, then it all goes up like a house of fire. So, and men typically respond much better to their partner's vulnerability. It sort of seems to elicit that caretaking, protector, masculine thing. So And that doesn't mean that a woman has to play dead or play weak, but just to tap into that vulnerability that we all have, paradoxically, that also shows him it's okay to be vulnerable, that this is a safe place where we can share that together, and it ultimately only makes us stronger. So I would say that to Gina. I would also say those moments where she wants to sort of go off on Martin and she's understandably frustrated, whatever she can do to calm herself down, take a time out, go talk to Pam, if she's being helpful.
You mean to tell me that your brand new husband is at the pool hall playing pool on his first night back? Pam, please, please stay out of married people's business. He'll be home by 8.
I'm not in your business, Gina. Okay.
But if I was in your business, I would tell you that it's 8:15. Don't you think I know that?
And kind of come back and say, I love you, and this is why I want to work this out.
And that's one thing I tell my clients to watch for, that to understand that that's what's going on. And I'll tell them individually. I'll tell the person, usually a woman, who is formally educated, that when you're communicating with your husband, you have to understand that he is not understanding where you are. He is not understanding your thinking on the issue. And so you have to talk to him at a level where he understands, without his knowing that you're doing it, and without his feeling as though you're talking down to him or condescending.
But baby, when you don't call me, when you don't return my page, I worry. I mean, put yourself in my position. How would you feel?
I'd say Gina could be a better partner, like I said, by understanding some of his vulnerabilities. And there's a book called The 5 Love Languages that has couples explore, you know, how do you show love? And so for her, maybe understanding how Martin shows his love towards her.
I was thinking maybe we should do something special.
Really?
Yeah.
Really, Martin?
Yeah, that's right, girl. Shoot, we ain't gonna be sitting around here on this couch watching no TV all night. I was figuring we go in the bedroom watch a little TV. Kick back, you know, let the chill.
And so sometimes it doesn't look exactly maybe like what she would want or what she would expect, but it's important, again, to learn your partner and understand this is how the person is showing love to me. And so I'd say with Martin and Gina's relationship and whether they should stick it out or not, I mean, yes, they are very different. So I've done some training in Imago couples therapy, and the idea is that couples can work. And it's helpful for each person to understand, again, this is the vulnerability I'm bringing in. So if Gina's vulnerability is, I'm too bougie, or he thinks I'm too bougie, he thinks I think I'm better than him, to help them dialogue about that and understand, you know, for Martin, maybe that comes from a place of insecurity. He really cares about her. Maybe he's afraid that she's going to leave him because, you know, she's too different. And so it's not that he actually, you know, even if he doesn't like those things, I mean, couples do not have to like the same things. Obviously, it is important that they have some overlap, but it's not uncommon for people to have different interests. And so maybe one time he'll go to the ballet with her, stick it out. Maybe she'll go to a sporting event or something that she doesn't particularly like just because. And so helping couples understand where that tension comes from. It may not always be a place of, I really don't like you because I think you're too bougie, but it could be the flip side, which is like a vulnerability. Like, what if she thinks she's too good for me and she leaves me? I really care about her, but I don't want her to leave. And so you sort of go after that thing that's the vulnerable point.
I'm gonna take some time to myself, all right? You know, try to get myself together, find out who I am, Gina. You know, learn how to be a man. Keep my head to the sky, Gina. All right, baby? You know what I'm saying? Get the wind beneath my wings, because I know I got them, baby. You know?
I don't see the union continuing. No, because first of all, he's so steeped in this idea that he's not a man. He's so insecure about not being a man because she's more educated than he is, that really will create a problem. There's no intellectual parity. That's the big thing, and there has to be in order to make a relationship work.
Nothing about art, Martin.
Yeah, well, I know that butt looks better in a box than it does on my coffee table, Gina.
But I gave it to you.
Yeah, but you knew I wouldn't like it.
Yeah, but you should have liked it. Martin, you need to grow up.
Oh, why do I need to grow up, Gina? Just because I like to hang out with my partners instead of going to some bougie museum? Huh? Just because I like to have fun around my place and put a damn smile on your face?
No, because you're not in third grade anymore. You're in a relationship. And if you keep making fun of everything about me that you don't understand, then I don't know how we're gonna go on.
So they can't move the relationship forward. It's going to stay stagnant in one place, and it's going to be frustrating for both partners. And eventually, they'll do things to even damage the relationship more. Like he may go out and have an affair, or she may go out and have an affair. And that destroys the foundation of a marriage. Now, there are cases, and I know people are talking about, we'll talk about, there are cases where a partner or a party has not been formally educated, but yet that party has learned to think critically and to do all of the same things that people learn to do when they go to college. So those marriages probably can work. And also you hear people talking about you can't help who you love. Well, you can. You can make the right choices, because all of life is about making choices. And making the right choice is important to you. If you meet somebody and you're attracted to them usually physically at first, and you start talking with that person and you discover the person has not had a formal education, then it's probably best that you not continue that relationship. That's a choice that you can make right then and there.
There's no recipe where you say, well, if they have this, then it absolutely won't work. I mean, people are amazing and they have such capacity to bring from the best part of themselves, and loving somebody is the best motivator of all to do that. I think for Gina and Martin, knowing that this is a hot button issue, for Martin, it's the insecurity of, am I good enough? Or does she think that I'm less than her? And for Gina, it's recognizing that that is a hot button issue for him, and not to use it like in an argument or when she's frustrated with him, or if you went to college, you know this already. Those things that might slip off the tongue go really deep to wound when somebody has a trigger in that area. I think with these things that we're talking about in place, Martin and Gina's relationship definitely could, I think every relationship can work until they say it can't. And really it would be up to Martin and Gina. I think they love each other, they're highly motivated, and if they're willing to look at their own stuff and compromise on the way they work together, absolutely.